the 3M PELTOR ComTac XPI and the SORDIN Supreme 1000cc Slim. Both products engineered to do the same thing, both also very well known among shooting and military communities, and yet both very different from each other. But which one should you go for? Well, with the help of this video, we'll let you decide yourself, because we will compare them by objectively laying out the facts. Before we dive into both of these products, we would like to ask you to subscribe to our channel and hit the bell button to stay tuned for more videos like this one. Also, go have a look at ReconBrothers.com for our blogs and giveaways, and make sure to support us by buying your shooting products over shop.ReconBrothers.com. We only provide top quality and ship worldwide. You can also find both SORDIN and 3M PELTOR products and accessories over our shop, so certainly interesting to have a look. That being said, we here today have the current finest workhorses of both the SORDIN and PELTOR brand, namely the SORDIN Supreme 1000cc Slim and the PELTOR ComTac XPI, also known as the ComTac V in the USA. Now, a thing that will probably need some clarification for most people out there is that we didn't mention SORDIN as being MSA SORDIN. This is because MSA and SORDIN are now, after a decade of working together, two separate companies again. This is because SORDIN can now focus on R&D again, aside purely production. So if you happen to come across any MSA SORDIN products, remember that those are versions with older technology. Now, moving on with this video subject. As you may know, the two headsets we have here are both the military versions of these two brands. In practice, this means they both provide hearing protection, situational awareness, and radio communication all in one. But even though they do the same thing, they are still very different products that provide a solution in their own unique ways. Our job here today is to show you those differences so you can decide for yourself which one to go for. In order to do this, we'll be going over different categories to compare the two to each other. The first will be their build, the second their features, and as the third will show you a sound comparison. So let's start with our first category, their build. The first option is one that decides a lot in practice, and that is either a headband, a neckband, or a helmet-attached headset. Let's begin with the headband versions first. The SORDIN comes with a slim black leather headband. For the PELTOR here in Europe, that is also the case, but in the USA they have implemented a new removable soft plastic headband wrap in the package. If you're looking for this headband here in Europe, we also provide them, but only separately. Both the SORDIN and the PELTOR are designed to be worn underneath a helmet with their headbands, and that's the advantage of going for this build option. Aside this, you have the neckband versions, and here PELTOR isn't that very popular since it doesn't allow you to look up, because the neckband blocks the movement of your neck. The SORDIN doesn't have this problem, and thus here it provides the best neckband design. Now, as for a very common asked question, whether you should go for a headband or a neckband, in our and both brands their experience, for most people the headband will be the most comfortable one. There is only a small group of people that like the neckband build. At last, there is also another option, and that is the helmet mounted ones. When it comes to this, both SORDIN and PELTOR can come with ARC helmet adapters out of the box. This is obviously only useful if you have a helmet with ARC rails, but in general it is not a recommended thing to get your headset like this. In general, it is much smarter to get a headset version and your adapter separately. Because one, not every helmet system uses ARC rails, you also have Team Wendy and M-Lock rails, and two, you can never use your headset without a helmet. Now, getting one with a headband does require to cut the leather wrap if your headset is equipped with one. If it's removable, then you're in luck. But anyway, having them like this allows you to go back to the headband version if you need to in the future. If you did need to cut the wrap, you can buy textile replacement headbands to cover the bridge again and use it as firstly intended. FYI, I did only mention the headbands to do it like this because the neckbands are not as easy to transform into a helmet mounted setup and back again. As just mentioned, beside ARC rails, there are also helmets with M-Lock and Team Wendy rails, and the solutions to mount either a SORDIN or a PELTOR headset on those exist as well. Team Wendy currently provides adapters for PELTOR, and Unity Tactical makes adapters available for M-Lock rails. Currently there are solutions from Unity Tactical to mount Sordin headsets on these two rails as well, but they are expensive solutions. However, we have brought Team Windy and Sordin together for a new solution which they are currently working on, so as soon as they are available, you'll know where to find them. For M-Lock, you'll currently still have to go for the Unity Tactical solution. However, there's a big but, and we've only learned this recently, but we do believe it is important to mention this. Sordin has let us know that you best don't use helmet adapters from just any third party you can find, because there's a lot that comes along with these presumably simple items. The thing is that these companies test and guarantee the seal of these adapters on all the official helmet systems compatible with them. And that is not necessarily the case for those third-party ones, which means you still risk getting hearing damage. So best thing to do is to look for the ones provided by either the headset or helmet manufacturers themselves, since they work together on creating these solutions. We don't know whether Unity Tactical has done all the necessary tests, but we do know they didn't work together with Sordin in their engineering process, and that will be highly likely the case with PELTOR as well. So having that covered, the second option you can choose is the color of the cups on the headsets. For both the Sordin and the PELTOR, those can either be green or black, and for those people that live in the USA, PELTOR also provides a coyote brown version. Now, if you're looking for a more exotic color, that is also a possibility, but it is not provided by these companies themselves. It is provided by a brand called Gearskin, which produces Cordura wraps with some very cool features like being fire and abrasion resistant, water, oil and acid repellent, and even provides IR camouflage. The nice thing about these adhesive sheets is that you can get them in a lot of different colors and patterns, and they come in pre-cuts as well. Currently, they are already available for the 3M PELTOR ComTac headsets, and yes, you can buy them over our shop as well. As for the Sordin headsets, that is currently not yet the case, but we've put these two companies in contact to see if there's a way of them to work together. Another build option is the microphone. Here, PELTOR gives you the option to go for a dynamic or a flexible version, whereas the flexible one is more expensive. Sordin, on the other hand, doesn't leave an option open and only delivers their headset with a flexible one. Now, a thing that is immediately noticeable is that the PELTOR microphone can be removed, while that is not possible for the Sordin version. Whether that's a good or a bad thing, we'll totally leave that up to you. To some it might be a practical thing, while others don't need it, and rather have something that doesn't have the potential of coming loose. Another thing regarding the microphone, and this is especially important to you left-handed guys out there, is that Sordin can provide their headsets with a microphone on the right side, straight from the factory. For this they charge only a small extra cost. For the ComTac XPI, the possibility is also there, but it is not that simple. In order to acquire a left-handed PELTOR, you will require to buy a standard ComTac XPI without a microphone and downlead, and you will have to buy a separate microphone upgrade kit with all the individual pieces. Above that, you'll have to assemble the entire thing yourself. By the way, these kits are also provided by us over our webshop if you're interested in getting one. The ComTac V in the USA, however, is equipped with a microphone input on the right side, so you can change the mic position however you desire. FYI, for the guys living here in Europe that would want a ComTac V, we can already tell that a legit import won't be possible since it doesn't have a CE marking, so you'll have to do with the ComTac XPI. Next are the single and dual COM options. For this, both manufacturers can provide headsets with a single or a double downlead. Obviously, the dual versions are more expensive sets. If you happen to have a single downlead and still need to work with two radios, there is also the option to get a dual PTT that takes in that one downlead and connects to two radios. Sordin provides these PTT versions themselves, while that is no longer the case for PELTOR anymore. In overall, such PTTs are not cheap, but comparing that to a dual headset with two separate single PTTs, that will still seem like a bargain. And it also saves you space on your carrier, by the way. Now that we're talking about PTTs and such, let's talk a bit about their wiring and downleads. Both the Sordin and PELTOR utilize the same downlead cable, namely a Nexus TP120 or a U174U. PELTOR refers to it as a J11 plug, which has more to do with the history of the plug, but anyway, it's just the same as the others. Furthermore, there's another important thing, and that is wiring. As for sorting, it is very simple. They standard provide products with US NATO wiring, which allows them to be compatible with other PTT systems like the Nexus one. Sorting can provide UK NATO and Savox wiring as well. PELTOR, on the other hand, has two options, whereas one is NATO wired and the other is what's called PELTOR wired. In the USA, PELTOR fabricates their headsets with NATO wiring, and in Europe you get the two options. But now, what does this imply in practice? Well, NATO wired headsets only work properly with NATO wired PTTs, and the same goes for PELTOR wired systems. If you combine them, you can get things like receiving sound through your microphone, and that is not what you want. Usually guys here in Europe that get their PELTOR from the USA have to deal with this problem, and luckily the solution is only a simple adapter cable away. Now, going further down the list of their build, we can furthermore mention they are both absolutely rugged pieces of equipment, so as a matter of durability, they'll both probably last equally, which can be a lifetime if you take care of them. Next we come to both products, their profile, and here there's quite a difference. As can be immediately seen, the Sordin headset provides a more slimmer and streamlined profile with its cup design than the PELTOR does. Aside their profile, there's also the matter of seal and comfort. And also here, there are some noticeable differences. Despite them both having roughly the same cup size, looking from the outside, there are some big differences going on the inside of the speakers. For starters, if we look at the speaker cushions, we can see that the Sordin has much more space for the ears compared to the PELTOR. So how does this differ in practice? Well, one is the overall ear fitment for most people, and the other is when mounting these things on a helmet. If you do this, it can occur that the cups are not always 100% perfectly outlined with your ears. And it can happen that the top of your ears are pressing against the cushions, and thus there's no complete seal. So with the Sordin headset, that is less likely, since they provide more space. Furthermore, when it comes to the seal, there's another matter with the design of the cushions themselves. If we look at the PELTOR, you can see that the foam cushions are flat and pretty edged designed. The Sordin has far more curved cushions, and they feature a small bump on the bottom. This might not seem a big deal at first, but if you have worn both headsets, you'll quickly notice the difference. With the PELTOR, it may occur that there's a small open gap on the bottom where the cup meets the jawbone, and in order to get rid of it, you'll have to adjust the sizing or wear it a bit differently. The Sordin doesn't have this issue because of that bump on the bottom, and thus you have an overall more complete seal. Now, just so you know, this is a matter if we're talking about the foam cushions. As for the gel cushions, this is no longer the case because they compress better to your head. And if we're talking about iPro, it is always recommended to use the gel cushions anyway because they already make an immense difference in comfort and seal, even when wearing thin temple glasses. Next is their sizing, and we can tell by comparing them to each other, they both extend very similar. So if you fit at one and it does not work for you, then the other won't fit any better. The best solution for people that experience this issue is to go for a helmet mounted setup. Another pretty big difference about these headsets, their build, is that with the PELTOR it can happen you lose some parts. Things like the battery covers and the microphone windshields can be lost. This while the Sordin is built in such a way that nothing except the microphone windshield can be lost at all. The windshields have a rubber frame around them, and the battery cap is retained with a wire. So you could say that the Sordin is an overall less to worry about system when it comes to these parts. If you do need replacement parts for your PELTOR headset, we have made a replacement kit available on our shop, just so you know. Next is a fair warning for the attachment and removal of the PELTOR connectors when you want to switch between a headband and a helmet setup, for example. Here you want to watch out you don't break them, because apparently that can happen quite easily. It never happened to us, but we can see why that might happen often, since you can easily do it wrong and it requires force as well. Just so you know, for the removal of these, you want to turn them 90 degrees and pull them straight off. For attaching them, you also go into that horizontal position and use a wrench to correctly apply the needed force. We personally recommend to actually not touch these connectors at all and simply pull the arms out of the connectors and insert the next ones. At last, regarding the build, the Sordin does have an inconvenient thing with taking out the batteries, because The two batteries go in one and the same compartment and sit on top of each other. For this, the first battery that goes in has to drop down, and taking that one out again can be a real pain, quite literally even. Because for this, all you can do is smack that battery loose. No worry, you won't damage the headset, it can take it, but for your hand that will be another story. And obviously for the PELTOR this is not the case, because each battery has its own battery compartment. That is all regarding the build, so let's have a look at their features. For this we're going to start with a headset, its most important feature, and that is the level of protection it offers against hazardous sounds. To get an overall idea of how well the Sordin or PELTOR does that, you have to look at what's called the signal number rating, or SNR. If you're not familiar with this, the SNR is an average passive reduction the headset provides over different frequencies, usually going from 125 Hz up to 8000 Hz. This means in practice that if you're, for example, in an environment with 100 decibels and your headset has an SNR of 25 dB, you're left with 75 dB underneath your headset. The only problem with this rating is that it doesn't provide any indication at low or high frequencies. You can imagine that there must be a difference in blocking the high frequency of an explosion like a gunshot, or the low frequency of a running engine from a helicopter, for example. The lower frequencies are much harder to block, and thus depending on what you do, this may require entire different headset systems. Anyway, to get an idea of this, you will have to look at the high, medium, low values of the headset, which are indicated with an H, M and L, and those are usually shown next to the data tables of the product. So having that explained, the PELTOR provides an SNR of 28 dB and the Sordin provides 26 dB. If you wear earplugs underneath, the SNR of the PELTOR will rise up to 39 dB. For the Sordin, this value is not given, and why that is the case will become clear in a bit. Now obviously by hearing these values, the PELTOR provides a better protection than the Sordin does. Moving on, we come to the ambient levels of both headsets, in other words, how you can adjust the noise level inside the cups. For this, the PELTOR has one silent mode and four ambient levels, whereas the speakers are maxed out at 82 decibels. The silent mode is basically a mode where the external mics are shut down, but the system is still on. At first thought, you might think that isn't useful in any way, since it basically does the same as when the system has been shut off, only it now uses battery life. The reason why this exists has to do with the PELTOR having some pretty modular settings, which we'll talk about later, and using this silent mode allows those to be still active, unlike when the system is off. Anyway, the Sordin on the other hand has 5 ambient levels and is also maxed out at 82 decibels, and as for a silent mode, there is none. Speaking of battery life, the PELTOR is stated to have a battery life of 200 hours, but in reality that can go up to 300 hours. Of course, this depends on the used batteries and the temperature, so it's all still an estimation. If we look at the Sordin, the stated battery life is 600 hours, which is double of the PELTOR, and quite impressive actually. But again, also here, it's still an estimation. By the way, both use AAA batteries to run. Another thing, when it comes to the battery life, is that both headsets have a low battery warning signal. For the Sordin, the warning will be given if about 40 hours of battery life is left, while with the PELTOR this is given when the last 2 hours are going in. Furthermore, they both also have an auto shut-off feature that initiates if there hasn't been any button input for a certain amount of time. For the PELTOR that time is 2 hours, while for the Sordin that is 4 hours. Now we did notice that the use of a PTT button isn't counted as an input for the PELTOR headset, and it still shuts down after those 2 hours. And the quite annoying thing about this is that you just get a signal and it shuts down immediately, so you don't even get the time to react to it. As for the Sordin, we haven't had it shut down automatically yet, probably because it already takes 4 hours to come to that point. Moving on, another good feature about both comms is that if they are plugged into a radio and their batteries happen to fail, their comm systems will still work. You will have to do with passive hearing protection, but you can still receive and send out messages. Now that we're talking about radio communications, we do want to mention that both systems work very well and reliably when it comes to transmitting and receiving messages. Of course, given that you use a decent radio and the appropriate PTT systems. We never experienced messages not coming through or going out. Every message comes in clearly. Both systems, their microphones are also equipped with a very good noise cancelling feature that allows for clear communications even in very windy conditions. Next we come to their ratings. Both headsets are built and tested according to the MIL-STD-810 military standards, meaning they can withstand a whole bunch of extreme conditions. Low pressure, temperature shock, fungus, pyro shock and gunfire shock are only a few on the list. A result of this is that both headsets are also waterproof. Now this is something that cannot be officially confirmed since both devices are non-closed systems, but they did go through those IP tests and survived without a problem. So although they don't have the IP label, they can withstand for a duration of 30 minutes up to 1 meter deep when immersed in salt water. For clear water this goes even longer, so any sort of moisture won't be any problem. Aside this, they both also have a very broad operating range. For the Sordin this goes from minus 20 degrees up to 50 degrees Celsius, and for the Pelter that is minus 44 up to 55 degrees Celsius. Now aside all these features, the Sordin also has an additional one that the Pelter doesn't have, which is an RFI protection class 1. This basically means that it doesn't interfere or gets interrupted from surrounding electromagnetic fields, which can play a part near, for example, power lines, radio towers, engines and so on. That's it, we are now going to talk about some features the Pelter has and the Sordin doesn't have. And the thing with these is that both companies have their very own ideas about which are useful and which are not. We'll explain them to you and then it's for you to make up your own mind about them. The first one is that the Pelter has a voice-guided menu while the Sordin works with simple tones. Is it necessary? No, but if you'd like to hear a non-nagging woman's voice once in a while, then you should certainly pick a Pelter. Just kidding. We totally get why Pelter did this, because the ComTac is a pretty adjustable system with various features, which we'll directly come to. This while the Sordin is not that modular. The next feature a Pelter has is a so-called balance. The idea here is that if you have hearing damage on an ear, it gets amplified extra to work against that damage. This is pretty clever at first thought, but Sordin doesn't think this is very useful since if you have hearing damage, your brain gets used to it and thus shifting that balance won't add any value. It will more likely confuse you for those couple of hours of wearing the headset, and that's why the Sordin doesn't feature this. Another feature of the Pelter is the ability to adjust the release time. This can either be set to fast or slow and apparently works against acoustic shocks caused indoors. Sordin's reaction to this feature was that they were quite curious about what it would do and told us to test it out for ourselves. But as of now, we personally don't have enough experience with shooting firearms indoors yet, so we haven't been able to test this out. And at last we come to the last unique feature of the Pelter, which is what they call an earplug mode. Remember when I was talking about SNR values and mentioned that the Pelter provides 39 dB with earplugs? Well, this is about that. Pelter did this to provide a system that can be more widely used for units that work a lot around loud engines, for example. But the extra protection you get from wearing earplugs together with the headset also comes with the downside that you lose your situational awareness. The earplug mode is a solution to that, whereas the Pelter amplifies the speakers with an additional 6 dB, which is a pretty smart solution to regain that situational awareness. Now, as said earlier during the explanation of SNR values, I also said that the Sordin hasn't given any values for this. Well, this is simply because they don't provide a solution to maintain that situational awareness when wearing earplugs underneath the headset. Now you might ask why not, and that has to do with how they approached the designing of their systems. There are two points here, one being that Sordin doesn't try to approach the market of, for example, tank units with their MIL-CC headsets, since they know these require special designed headsets. And two, a Sordin system is used as it comes. It doesn't allow to be adjusted like a Pelter, with the simple reason that it is built to do that one job the best it can, and this for as long as possible. So having said that, we now come to the final comparison of these two headsets, and that is a sound comparison. To give an idea of the difference in how these two devices block and produce sounds, we're going to show you two tests. The setup for these are pretty simple. We will expose the headsets to both a voice recording and the shots of an airsoft gas blowback gun, since its shots are loud enough to show you the difference. While doing so, we will record the sound inside the cups by using the microphones of our phones. We will do this with two phones, so we can show you the exact same sound, but from two different perspectives. As for the first test, we'll simply expose both headsets to the voice recording and the shots while they are set to their highest ambient settings. And no, not the earplug mode with the PELTOR. As for the second comparison, we'll show both perceptions again, but now we'll compare both their lowest and highest ambient modes to each other. Again, not with the earplug mode for the PELTOR. So guys, that was our comparison. Hopefully this video made a lot of stuff clear to you. Now it is up to you to decide which system to go for. Make sure to let us know which one that is in the comments below. If you're looking for either one of these headsets or any of their accessories, go have a look at shop.reconbrothers.com. And even if you can't find what you're looking for, just write us an email so we can help you out. If the video was helpful, make sure to leave a like. Thank you for watching. And you'll see us next week again.